Good morning, dear students. Today we are going to start new unit, Nurture Nature. That we are going to start with first topic of this unit, that is fire in the forest. Which is written by Nora Brook. So before starting with the topic, let us know something about Nora Brook. She was born in 1907 and died in 1976. She is a well-known English writer. She is famous for describing Indian way of living in the early 20th century. Her famous work includes Midnight Forests, Jungle Child and 11 Leopards. So now, as the name indicates, fire in the forest. You must have understood that the forest has got fire. You must have seen many news about forest fires, and in this how the animals are trapped and they have to suffer a great loss, isn't it? So sometimes the forest department lit the controlled fire, set controlled fires. So why do they set controlled fires? Because these controlled fires help in killing the wild fires. This lesson is about a hind and a fawn. Hind means a female deer and fawn is baby. Okay, young one of a deer is called fawn. So in this story, you are going to see the close relationship between a mother and a child. There is a close relationship between mother and a child, whether it is a human or an animal. So mother and a child are very close to each other, and mother sacrifices everything for her children, isn't it? In this lesson, you will see the survival of a hind and its fawn, how they try to save themselves from this forest fire. So let's get started. The fire spread rapidly. The smoke was seen by the forest department people, who immediately went into the action to halt the fire and prevent any further damage and death. Now the fire spread rapidly in the forest, and as the fire spread, there was smoke in the air, and the fire department people could see the smoke of fire, so they immediately took an action to stop the spread of fire and to prevent any damage and death. As you know that due to fire there will be a great loss to the life as well as to the trees, right? Animals and trees, there will be a loss for them, and so to prevent any further damage or death, the fire department people, they took immediate action. Soon men were on the next fire line, already cut through the jungle for exactly this purpose. All trees and undergrowth cleared away. Now some men from the fire department. They went near the fire line, which was already made before. Now these fire lines, the fire land is a strip of land which is cleared among the vegetation. So that much part of land is cleared. The trees and undergrowth plants all are cut down. And especially these fire lines are made for this purpose, that to stop the forest fire. So the purpose of the fire line is to stop the spread of forest fire. So immediately all the people from forest department went to the fire line. They lit their counter fire all along the edge of the fire line. Now the forest department people, what did they do? They lit the counter fire. Now why this forest department people lit the counter fire? So that there would be no further spread of fire. When the two fires met, there would be nothing left for them to burn. So they would both go out. So now when these two fire would meet, that is the fire which was already spread and the counter fire, when they would meet each other, there would be nothing left to be burned, and hence the fire would go out. And keeping that aim in mind, the fire department lit a counter fire. But meanwhile, the two furnaces were closing in on each other. So meanwhile, what happened? The two furnaces, furnaces means your fire. So the two fires, they were coming close to each other. Among the speckled shadows, a spotted deer was lying by herself away from the herd because she had recently given birth to a fawn. Now among the speckled shadows, speckled means occasional patches of light. See, whenever you sit under a tree during the day and you can see on the ground, that somewhere you can see the shadow of the tree, somewhere there is no shadow, isn't it? So as the rays of the light pass, the shadow falls down, isn't it? So that is called as speckled. Speckled means like spots. So the deer was lying in this among the speckled shadow, and this deer was away from the herd. Herd, a group of deer is called as herd. So this deer was away from the herd because she had recently given birth to a child. The deer gave birth to a child recently, and due to that she was away from the herd. Like all other deer, she never thought about tigers and panthers unless she could actually see one. But she was on the alert the whole time. Her great ears never still, but continuously flicking this way and that to throw off flies and bring her news. Now this deer, she did not bother about the tigers and panthers. She did not worry about them unless the deer could see them. Deer, don't worry about tigers and panthers. You know that deer is a prey of tigers and panthers. But they don't worry about them unless and until they see them. And so this deer also was not worried about them, but she was always alert, and her ears were not still. They were always flicking. Flicking means moving. So her ears were always moving here and there to keep away the flies and as well as to bring the news. So the ears were always alert to get the news about the surrounding. She bent her head to the fawn. Her tiny brown body lay like a nut in the pocket of grass. She bent her, she means we are deer. Deer bent down towards the fawn. Now if the fawn was on the ground, so the deer bent down to the fawn. And as the fawn was very small, it had recently taken birth, so it looked like a brown nut in the grass. So the deer looked like a brown nut. If you must have seen the nuts, they are also brown in color, and deer was also brown in color, and it was very small, so it looked like a nut in the grass. As she leant over him, he raised his face to hers and they touched. So as the deer leant over the fawn raised his face, and both deer and fawn touched each other. She got to her feet and stood with outstretched neck, staring nervously upwind. She got to her feet. Now the deer got to her feet, means she stood up, and she stood with her neck stretched out. She was very nervous, and nervously she was staring in the direction of the wind. She stamped lightly to warning. She stamped lightly in warning and stood ready to stamp again, waiting. So after getting up, the deer stamped on the ground. She stamped her foot on the ground in warning. Then she was in a ready position to stamp again. So she was waiting to stamp her foot again. Yes, it was a smell. Her eyes began to smart and she sneezed. Now she understood the danger. She got the news about the danger. Now there was a smell. The deer could smell something, and her eyes had some sort of pain. So when there is a smoke in the air, our eyes starts paining, isn't it? So that sort of pain the deer had in her eyes, and she also sneezed due to the smell. The wind was picking up and the heat of the fire increased and changed its direction. Now the wind was picking up. The wind started blowing fast, and the heat of the fire also increased with the wind, and it changed its direction. She stopped anxiously to her fawn, then up again to look and listen. So now she could feel the danger around her. So she stopped near the fawn anxiously. Anxiously means she was afraid now about the danger, and fearfully she stood near the fawn. Then again she stood up to look around and to listen. After a while, smoke could be seen in the sky. The hind sprang sharply to her fawn and nudged him to his feet. So after some time, the deer could see the smoke around. So what did she do? She sprang. Sprang means jumped. So the deer jumped to her fawn. Now she understood that there was a danger. So she immediately jumped to the fawn. Now if there is a danger, so what a mother does, she tries to save her child first. She doesn't care for herself, but she tries to save her child in any condition. Similarly, this hind, that is female deer, the mother deer, she immediately jumped to the fawn and nudged him to his feet. And nudged means a light push. So she pushed the fawn lightly to his feet. He got up shakily. His legs were as soft as those of a newborn lamb, and his hooves the size of thumbnails. Now, as the deer pushed the fawn stood up shaking. His legs were very soft as that of a baby lamb, and the hooves of fawn were as the size of thumbnails. Hooves means a horny part of an animal. You must have seen the horse, legs of horse. So in front of its feet there is some horny part that is called as hoof. Singular is hoof, plural hooves. So the hooves of this baby deer, that is fawn, were very small, like it was the size of thumbnails. He gave a little frisky jump and fell over. So he gave a little frisky means playful jump and fell over. As the mother pushed him, he gave a playful jump and again fell down. As it had recently taken birth, it was not able to stand properly. He got up again and came playfully towards her. So he again, the fawn got up and playfully came towards the deer. She threw anxious glances about her as she began suddenly to urge him along. So the deer, mother deer, anxiously looked at the fawn and she began to urge him along. She began to persuade him to get up from there and to move to another safe place, because she knew that their life was in danger. So she was trying to persuade the fawn to get up and walk along with her. They had to hurry. He was so slow, so weak and disobedient too. Now they had to hurry, otherwise their life would be at risk, as there was fire in the forest. But the deer was very slow. It was also very weak and also disobedient. It did not obey the mother. He kept sinking down, exhausted, refusing to get up again. So the fawn kept on sinking down on the ground. He was very much tired and refused to get up again. She forced her baby on with rough bites, nipping his soft flesh. So mother deer, now to save him, what she did? She forced her baby to walk. So how did she force? With rough bites, nipping the flesh. Now what do you mean by nipping? Means giving small sharp bites. So she kept on biting the flesh of the fawn so that he could get up and run from there. He squealed and staggered along, frightened now, not of the fire, but of her, his mother. Now he squealed. Squealed means a long, high-pitched cry or noise. So the fawn started making loud noise or crying loudly. And now the fawn was afraid, was frightened. Now what was he frightened about? Was he frightened about the fire? No. The fawn was not frightened about the fire, but he was frightened about his mother. He was frightened about the deer. Now why he was frightened? Because she gave him small sharp bites. And so the fawn did not understand why mother was biting him. And so he was afraid. The only thing he understood, who had turned on him. So the only thing the fawn understood was that who had attacked on him. Now he understood that his mother had attacked on him because she was biting him. So he only understood that his mother has attacked him, and so he could not understand why she was doing so. But now the roar of the furnace was close behind them. Terror bet in the fawn's body. He was suffering now. He staggered and fell, couldn't get up and lay quivering. But now the fire was very close to them. Now the fawn could feel the heat of the fire. So terror bet in the fawn's body and the fawn was afraid. He staggered and fell, couldn't get up and lay quivering. He staggered means he walked unsteadily and he fell down as he was very weak, as he was recently born, he was unable to walk properly. So he walked unsteadily, he staggered and fell down and lay quivering. Quivering means trembling or shaking. What do you think? What would have happened next? Would the deer be able to save the fawn? So we'll see in our next part. Till then, be safe. Thank you.